everybody, and welcome to... Holy Corey, what'd you do?
What do you mean, what I do? Oh, is that... I thought that was my headphones.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think that there's any difference between what we say or what we don't. It doesn't matter.
Okay.
Hey, everybody, welcome to episode 170 of Schnozcast on Saturday, April 23rd, 2022. All right, this is Bob, joined by my co-host today, Corey Selesky, and special guest Greg Gumto. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Fantastic. We are down two hosts tonight. Nick and Todd are on special assignments. Let's hope they're separate and individually unique, and not the same special assignment.
I was going to say they're probably with each other.
Well, probably.
Yeah. The love that dare not speak its name. So hey, if you're new to the podcast, welcome. Please continue to join us here every week. We release on Fridays at 10:30 a.m. Eastern Time out on all of your podcast platforms, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, wherever you can get a podcast. And actually, when you look for us and you search for us out there, let's just say it's Apple Podcasts. You're going to search for Schnozcast. You'll find us. You'll find all the episodes that were fit to release going back a couple of years now. I think it's going on three. And when you find us, please subscribe, give us a like, follow us. I think an Apple Podcast is a follow and not a subscribe. So that'll tell you when we release a new episode every Friday. And do us a favor and give us a rating. We've been doing a little bit of research here trying to figure out, well, how do we actually get... You know, how do we increase our listener base? I use Apple Podcasts, so I can't really speak for a whole lot of the other platforms, maybe Spotify, but each of them has the capability to give us a rating of some kind. So if you can find it in your hearts to give us a listen, to rate us how you feel, obviously 5-star ratings are welcomed, but any rating would be great, and that'll help us to grow.
I heard Apple actually changed their rating system. It's only 5 stars now. It's all you can give. So
yeah, well,
just hit the 5 stars right away and be done.
Yeah, seems legit.
Yeah,
yeah. Who knows better than Corey about?
Let me fact check. Yep, it's good.
Yeah, perfect.
Listen, don't listen. Just hit that 5 stars.
You can also follow us out on Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube, all at Schnozcast. You can email us with your existential questions that you'd like us to ask on the show, or request for relationship advice out to schnozcast@gmail.com, or you can call or text us at 618-SHOCKER. And then there's all the ways you can get a hold of us. So I got to start out with my notes. I like to do this because sometimes I don't remember what it is, which is half the fun.
You not remember something? No way.
Yeah. But this is actually very recent. So Lori and I were out to dinner with her son, and we're at a Mexican restaurant. And while we're sitting there, we're noticing that there are, you know, different people sitting around talking about different things. The restaurant was kind of crowded. We were waiting for our food. You know, the small talk had you know, burned itself out. So we're looking around and
semi-awkward silence.
Yeah. So Lori goes, you know what they need in these restaurants, what I think would be great is if they had drones that would just fly around the restaurant so that I could see what people were doing while they're waiting for their food. Greg, your thoughts?
I mean, I don't think it's doable, but...
Well, forget about the technical feasibility of the restaurant drones, but the notion that there are just a dozen... You know, drones are not quiet. They're
very, fairly loud. Very loud.
Buzzing above your head the whole time while you're sitting there.
I would just put a camera up and like the light.
Yeah.
This way you can just kind of see what's going on over there. Hit a button at your table and it goes to whatever table and pops on the camera, little microphone on the table.
Yeah. So I wanted to get to the bottom of what this fascination was. I'm like, do you want to see them eating? What is it that you're looking to
I think she's just being nosy and wants to know, or you're just very boring.
She was very, well... I was trying to keep the 10-year-old from, you know, falling asleep in the booth or kicking the table. But she was very specific. She doesn't necessarily want to watch people eat. She wants to hear what they're talking about while they're waiting for their food. I don't know why. But I feel like if she had a big, like, Batman-esque bank of monitors where she could just hit a button and then, you know, drop in on every table, that's really what she would want. And I don't know what to make of it. Besides telling her that I thought it was technically impossible to accomplish.
She can do that. She just has to go work for the NSA or CIA. Yeah.
But why a restaurant? Why, you know, what would be the point?
I feel like that was just her preface to it, that in actuality, she wants that everywhere she goes.
The restaurant, there's a typically a wide group of people, like a wide selection of people.
I think it depends on the restaurant.
Different backgrounds. But, yeah, different, you know. Okay. You might catch an awkward first date. Maybe people who are at the end of the line of their dating time.
Let's go for one more meal before we...
Let's see if we can patch this up and it just doesn't work.
Yeah, and Applebee's is where I've chosen to do that.
Yeah, I mean, keep it classy.
Okay.
Numerous things.
All right. What would your reaction be if you to this drone that was circling your table?
I think it would get swatted because the downdraft would just throw stuff out. I mean,
you haven't gotten your meal yet.
But if you're at a Mexican place, you got your chips and your salsa. Salsa over the table. I get mad.
These drones are so powerful. The downdraft is going to splash salsa over.
Depending
on
how big the drone is, I take mine up north to my family's place. Yeah. And they have a couple of sunlights up there, and there's some leaves that get on there. I take my drone, I put it right over top there, and it blows the leaves right out of the off of the light.
So you're saying that salsa doesn't stand a chance.
Sorry, you guys keep going.
Yeah, no problem.
I like where her head's at, because like there's sometimes you'd be like, look at that group of people over there. I wonder what they're talking about.
That's exactly where I think it came from, and I'm not sure why that's now the
thing.
Yeah. I'm like, I'm not against what
she wants to do, because I could be like sitting at a restaurant and you're like, I'm not saying this conversation is boring with the people I'm with.
But I wonder what those two are.
Those two look sketchy. And I kind of want to know what they're talking about.
Like they're planning crimes. Yeah.
I mean,
plotting heists.
We're better off
at the Applebee's. Okay.
2 for $20. Little crime.
I mean, I get it. There is a bit of voyeurism in that request or in that wish. But I mean, there's only been a few restaurants I've been to where I really gave a shit about anybody else in the restaurant who wasn't bringing me my food or bringing me my drinks or asking me for the bill. Otherwise, you know, your typical Applebee's, I just don't see anything worth spying on going on around me.
Yeah. I mean, I don't, like I said, there's very few times where you just look over at the table and go, that looks shady. Or if you see a group of people laughing, it's like, what are you guys laughing about over there? Kind of want to know.
We're like five girls all erupt in laughter at the same time.
Like, well, so funny. Looking at me and laughing. Okay.
Well, yeah, if they're laughing and pointing, that's one thing.
Yeah.
But I don't see the, I mean, I just, if there's something going on around you, I think it's more entertaining. Instead of knowing what they're actually talking about, it's more entertaining to make up a conversation at the table. Let's talk about what they're actually talking about. Let's make up a conversation for them.
You know, it could
I'll be her, you be him, and let's play this out.
It could be there's the teacher in her that wants to know when people are talking.
Yeah.
Type of thing. I don't know.
But then what is she going to do with that? Do you think that as a teacher she's going to come in and go like, whoa, okay, you were wrong. I mean, I just heard what you said, and I think everyone in this restaurant would agree that was out of line. You need to be a little more understanding. You two can patch this up.
There's a restaurant idea.
Yeah.
How funny would that be if you know you're being recorded and everybody else can hear you and you could have people looking over like, don't say that. That's not.
So everyone has to agree. Okay, let's follow this to its logical conclusion. You walk in the door.
Yep.
Right? It's called macaroni and stuff.
Yeah.
That's the name of the restaurant. And you walk in, you're like, I feel like some macaroni.
Mm-hmm.
But they go, hey, before we seat you, you have to sign a waiver because one of the tables in the restaurant is going to be recorded and piped into the headphones of everyone else at their tables. We're not telling you which one it is, but it could be you. So you have to sign this or we can't seat you.
I think you could even go one step further. It's kind of like that, what is that, that Dick's restaurant where they write stupid stuff on your hat.
Yes.
You kind of know what you're getting into.
Yeah, 100%.
Like when you walk in there.
They make fun of you at the table.
Correct. Yeah. You kind of know that's the kind of restaurant that it is.
Yeah.
Instead of having to sign a waiver, it's like, well, it's posted on the door. You know what you're getting yourself into. Here it is.
Right.
There's a little microphone, little camera.
Yeah. And everybody has to put in little earbuds.
You could have a speaker, a little switchboard with different table numbers. He's like, oh, what's going on that saying, table?
We're not picking just one table to pipe to every other table. We're picking like table 4 gets to listen to table 12.
Yep.
Table 7, they're listening to table 10.
Yep.
Okay.
I don't know the logistics of that whole wiring system. I feel like it could get a little out of hand.
I mean, it's all wires nowadays.
Yeah.
You just got to, it's wires and holes.
Plugs
and holes.
Plugs and holes. Yeah. Yep. That could be the name of the restaurant.
I thought I was pretty clear, Greg. We're going with macaroni and stuff. That's what we're going with. I think you might be onto something. We may have to revisit that.
I'm just trying to think, like, that could be kind of funny just because if you know you're getting yourself into something similar to that, you'd probably be a little bit mindful of your conversation. However, sometimes in the heat of the moment, mm-hmm. things are said.
Yeah.
It could be kind of funny for everyone.
Yeah. That's why I like the idea of pumping it out to everyone so that like broad cameras can watch like table after table after table at the same time. Just go, what?
Or
I can't believe he said that.
Or you could have it set up maybe kind of like a board, and you hit the board and you go, and it lands on something. And that's the table you get to listen to.
Right. So how do we prevent people from coming in there and fucking with us? Like if you have to sign that, you know what's going to happen. You're going to be less likely to talk about important shit and more likely to make up a conversation.
I feel like most people are just going to be making fun of something or making something up.
Yeah.
But it's all about that one unexpected people that really don't know what they're getting themselves into.
Right. What if you did it the other way? Like it just reversed it. Like Candid Camera used to do. Like you don't have them sign a waiver. You just do it. And then later on you go, hey, we're going to do this. We're going to release a podcast. We're going to do this for a TV show. And, you know, if you sign this waiver, you know, then we can use your footage. If you don't, then we won't. You know,
I want in the moment. Like I want to hear somebody say something, be like, you fucked up. Don't say that again.
See, that's why I don't think we're going to get that. If we have everybody sign the waiver first, because people aren't going to go, yeah. Yeah, let me just sign this waiver, and then you and I are going to finish our business at the table once we get there. I'm going to tell you what I think, what I really think. I just don't know if we're going to get lucky like that.
I guess it depends on where you have it at.
Yeah, Applebee's is probably not the place.
No. I feel like the conversations aren't going to be that great.
It would have to be somewhere where people from all walks of life, like you could get, you could pay $150 for a meal for two with really, really good food, or you could have, you could pay $60 for a family of four. You know what I mean? It's a widely varied menu.
You could have two separate restaurants. You could have the fancy high-end restaurant. What restaurant
listens to the other restaurant?
Yeah.
Okay.
But you don't know. You can't see them.
So the Plugs and Holes restaurant spying on the macaroni and stuff restaurant.
Yes. And vice versa.
I'm with you. I think we're onto something.
Oh, you want the high-end seats? Oh. Let me tell you what that includes.
What if these two restaurants were right next to each other?
That's what I was saying.
And hold on. You have your nicest booth right up in the middle of the wall, back of the restaurant. But behind that wall is the other restaurant, and there's a similar booth there. And like Indiana Jones in The Last Crusade, you can hit a button, switch. And it just spins the table, and all of a sudden, the hoity-toities are in the blue-collar restaurant and vice versa.
And then what you could do is put the bar rail in the middle. So you have all the fancy high-end stuff on one end where drinks are like $15. And that exact same drink on the other side is like $7.50.
Right. And you're going to spin that too.
Yeah. I think this could work.
This is going to be gold. Gold, Greg. Gold, I say.
This is going to be amazing.
I'm just coming back into this. I don't know what's happening.
What the fuck?
We'll revisit on the break, and then we'll get your two cents after the break.
I think he's in. I think he'll be in.
Oh, I think he'll be in for sure. But he might have some interesting twists to add to it.
Possibly.
All right. Mind if I get a little booze news, Corey?
Do it. All right.
Now it's time for booze news.
All right, I have two stories for you guys. This one's a really quick one. Were you aware that there was a website called doggywana.com?
Excuse me?
Doggywana.com. You're right. You guessed it, as in marijuana.com.
Oh.
Doggywana.com.
Doggywana?
Yeah.
So is it marijuana for dogs?
You would think so, wouldn't you?
That was my
thought.
I would most definitely think so.
But no. If you shop there, it turns out all it is treats and stuff for dogs, but there's catnip in it. No marijuana whatsoever.
Okay, but does catnip have the same effect on dogs as it does on cats?
No, it doesn't, which is even worse.
So you're just making...
Well, supposedly it chills them out a little bit, but dogs don't have the same receptors in their face that the cats do and the roof of their mouth, and that's why it drives cats crazy. Dogs aren't driven quite as crazy, but it doesn't have the same physical effect. But beyond that, why are you calling a website doggywana.com and there's no marijuana anywhere in any of your products?
I'm a little upset about it.
Yeah.
I mean, I get it, but to me too, again, it should be something that is like CBD for dogs.
Right.
That would make more sense.
Yeah. Huge letdown.
It's giving... I guess I would never think about giving a dog catnip and thinking that it was going to have the same effect. Like when you put the word cat in the name catnip,
yeah,
it's clearly meant for a certain species of animal.
Well, so let me read this to you. I intended in this being just a quick, like, here's what I think. It sucks. Don't ever go there. Obviously throwing away any chance to get sponsored by doggywana.com.
In all honesty, if they came to us right now, and even though we're unsponsored currently, I'd be like, yeah, I know your product sucks.
Kick your rock. Name is awful.
Kick rocks.
So according to their FAQ section, dogs have catnip receptors in their face and stomachs, similar to cats. Nepotilactone, the essential oil in catnip, binds to the receptors and induces a response that is so relaxing it's drool-worthy. Dogs don't get high from catnip like cats do. Instead, it's a calming agent when eaten and a great way to encourage your dog to play longer through smell. Cats have receptors in their cheeks and the roof of their mouths. This is why people and dogs don't get the same reaction from catnip than cats do. Now, that is all I'm going to... That's the last bit of press I'm going to give for doggywana.com. But if they'd like to prove me wrong and convince me that this is not an awesome product, they can email us at schnozcast@gmail.com and we'll give it a second look, I guess.
Indy, you want to try that out, buddy?
If I could try it on a hot
side. Well, of course he would, because it's some sort of food, but yeah. I don't think he necessarily get anything out of it.
No, and that's why it was so... I'm just like, this is... I got to bring this up because it's so annoying. So my second article, specifically because Greg's here, from Smithsonian Magazine, rare Viking sword discovered in grave on Scottish Island. Have you read this article yet?
Okay. I have not.
So archaeologists have revealed new X-ray scans of a Viking sword found on Scotland's Orkney Islands. This was found, and this is an older story. This is like 7 years ago. But
staying up to date with the Schnozcast.
I did. Well, it's
bringing you the most current breaking news.
It's an old Viking sword. It's not getting any newer. So this is information I didn't know.
But it's old news.
Guys, stop me if you knew this already. But... it's a 9th century weapon. It was one of several Viking artifacts discovered in a hidden cemetery on the northeast coast. And it was dubbed the Maybach sword after the site where it was found. The artifact is a Pedersen Type D sword. Greg?
Pedersen Type D.
Yeah. One of the heaviest used by the Vikings. Type D swords would need the balance of a substantial hilt to stabilize them, notes the archaeologist who found it. According to the blog post from the team, just 30 or so comparable swords survive today. Half were found in Norway. Others were recovered in Ireland, Slovakia, Poland, and Russia. But the Maybach is just one of two Type D swords known to scholars. The second was excavated in the 1830s in the Isle of Eigg.
Yeah, that's probably wrong.
One of E-I-G-G. Give it a try.
Eigg?
A-C? One of Scotland's Inner Hebrides Islands. Defining these swords is difficult, as two different scholars might classify a sword differently using the same system. But the name, the type of the sword is based on just one section of the weapon, which is the hilt. There's obviously a lot of corrosion and rust on the weapon, so it's very, very fragile. But they were able to lift it out of a block and transport it to a lab and then do some forensics on it at that point. So I know how big you are into weapons, crossbows, and the like. And so I'm like, yeah, old Viking sword right down Greg's alley.
I wouldn't mind having an old Viking sword. That'd be pretty sweet.
I think so.
I feel like this one's probably going to be up for auction soon.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I think if you ever swung at anything, it would just collapse into a million pieces in your fingers.
I'm going to have to make one.
You're going to make a Viking sword?
Somebody will.
I actually know a guy that makes his own knives. He's right out of his garage.
Yeah?
He's actually very good at it.
Have you ever looked at his...
Yeah, I've been there while he's been making. Have you
bought anything from him?
No. His stuff is way more for Greg. Like, if he made like little pocket knives, I'd be like, oh, okay.
This is more like a knife to kill several people. Yeah, one swipe.
These are slaying knives. Okay.
Slaying knives?
Yeah.
Is that a thing?
I would hope so.
All right.
Sounds trademark right.
Corey Selesky 2022.
Yeah. I'm sure there's some realm out there that uses slaying knives.
I feel like you're going to have this guy's phone number by the end of the end of the show.
That's the other interesting point about this guy.
No phone?
No. He doesn't have a cell phone.
Okay.
Does he have a house phone?
I'm sure he might have a house phone.
Pager?
For a very, very long time, it was a pager.
Okay.
They started making him carry a cell phone at work because all the supervisors were required to, and he was very, very upset about that. But okay. And we'd ask, like, well, what if your wife or kids, like, need to get a hold of you? They know my schedule.
I mean, like, the world did run. It did, you know.
Long time.
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
Michael, sun rises and sets whether you have a cell phone or not, so.
He's like, yeah, she knows when I'm at the desk and when she can call the desk, or if I'm on the road, then she's just going to have to wait until I call. So he's got a
desk phone.
Well, when he's at work, he has a desk phone. And right. Well, and a cell phone.
Well, I guess, that he's so I thought we were carry. Talking about the knives, the slaying knife lab, you know, workshop that he has.
Oh, I'm just saying good luck getting a hold of him, because I don't know how the hell you're supposed to do it.
You don't know the password, the secret knock.
I mean, do you think he just like, hey, I'm laser focused when I'm building these knives that can kill, you know, 12 people at a time. I don't want to be disturbed.
No, he's weird.
Okay. Does he have a pigeon coop in the backyard? Maybe that's how he goes around. Sends out a pigeon.
Pigeons are a little too alive for him.
Didn't Tyson have a pigeon coop? Yes. We saw where that leads. Did you guys see the thing about him beating the fuck out of somebody in an airplane?
That guy deserved it. That guy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I saw the footage. Sure.
He should be lucky that Tyson wasn't able to actually get like a legit punch. I can't remember from the clip.
Did he know that it was Mike Tyson?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Wait, he got a picture with that guy.
Okay.
Hang on.
Yeah.
This happened on a commercial flight?
Yes.
Yeah.
A JetBlue flight.
Why does Mike Tyson do any of the shit that he does?
That makes no sense.
I mean, the man pissed away millions and billions of dollars. So he probably, his agent's probably like, why don't you just try to save a little money in this
He's fight? Making a lot of money. He's in the marijuana field. And yep. Just
speaking of dog iguana.
Yeah. Tyson. Probably his company.
Tyson's got a weed company. Dan Aykroyd's got a weed company. No.
Vodka.
No, Jim Belushi's got a weed. Dan Aykroyd's got vodka. Belushi's got a weed company.
Alan Iverson just came out with a marijuana company too. Or no, he came out of a strand. I don't think a whole company.
Just a strand. Yeah. Oh, a strain.
Strand, sorry.
Yep.
But yeah, so yeah, Mike Tyson's on a commercial flight. Why?
He was sitting first class. Still.
Okay, it's Mike Tyson. How do you not have
Hold on. Do you think he should have had like his own private jet?
I mean, he doesn't necessarily have to own his own private jet, but
yeah.
Charter one.
Yeah. I mean,
depends on what was going on. I don't know the whole situation about where he was going. He had people with him.
I don't care where you're going. If you're Mike Tyson, you charter a jet flight.
I don't know that anybody
waste of money
really knew that there was going to be a danger that Mike might beat the fuck out of somebody on the plane.
Well, again, It's Mike Tyson. That's always the danger.
But right, but in that, by that logic, we should expect every week for Mike Tyson to be beating the fuck out of somebody somewhere.
Clearly, his handler has him under control enough.
Yeah,
he's got himself under control. Like, but this guy got a picture with him. The video's out there. Okay. And there's a couple different videos you can watch. He actually, I think he got a selfie with the guy first, and then the next video, like something cuts out. He threw a water bottle at Tyson, mm-hmm. and then started talking to Tyson, and Tyson turned around.
Tyson didn't react to the water bottle?
That's what kind of, then all of a sudden the video cameras came out.
Yeah.
And that's when they show the altercation. That's when the video cuts on, is right after somebody threw the water bottle at him, which was, the whole plane was like, yeah, that guy, I guess the guy was drunk.
Okay.
But yeah, Tyson hit him a couple times. Lucky he wasn't able to get like,
he would have killed him. I have no doubt that Tyson, up until the day he passes away, will still have 80% at least of that
power. Yeah, I've listened to him on a few different podcasts and just little like interviews with him. He's like, he's got everything so bottled up that anytime somebody brings something up, he's like, we're not talking about that. Because he goes, that's not the person I am anymore.
Right.
I'm trying to better myself.
Yeah, good for him.
Yeah, I mean, keep smoking weed if that's what it takes to keep you the old beast in the cage, so to speak.
Yeah, like, but I mean, since he's growing his own weed and he's getting on a commercial flight, albeit in first class, you would think that he would have smoked a little bit of that weed to calm him before the flight.
Possibly.
Which, if it's good weed, should have prevented him from beating the shit out of this guy.
Although with fuel being so expensive right now, that's probably why he didn't. I could imagine a chartered flight would be absolutely ridiculous right now. Or they couldn't get one.
Right.
My rebuttal is Mike Tyson.
It's Mike Tyson, yeah. Yeah, I don't know what he's worth now. I heard the marijuana thing is going great guns for him, which is great. But, you know.
We try to open our own weed company and the police are knocking at the door.
I never asked you, but did you ever, you know, Kevin Smith and Jay have a weed thing that they're doing?
I wouldn't doubt it.
I'm
surprised it took this long.
It's been several years that I think they were one of the first to put like a celebrity's name or, you know, face along with, I mean, granted it was his character Silent Bob, but yeah, I was wondering if you had ever.
No, I did not know. Up.
Okay.
His net worth is $10 million. Mike Tyson.
Jesus. It's a mere shadow of what it used to be.
I mean, but if you know, $100,000 or $200,000 to charter a flight, I don't know how much charter a flight is.
Last time I chartered a flight.
Yeah, exactly. Somebody call Todd. No.
you were riding with the livestock in the back of that flight.
I just said last time I chartered a flight, I didn't say where I was at on that flight.
Stowaway.
Yeah. All right, so that's booze news for the week. All right. I wanted to do this, even though Nick's not here. We do a little Nick's existential question of the week, and I'm going to let you guys decide because I know it's probably going to piss him off that we didn't. So kind of in this way, we've got a little bit of Todd and Nick on the show, even though they're not here. So, there's two ways we can go with this. I can ask an actual existential question, or I can joke it up a little bit, something that Nick would probably never do and probably wouldn't like.
It's sports related?
It's tough to get an existential sports question.
I say, considering he's not here, we might as well go with the route that would piss him off the most.
That's what
he would do.
Exactly.
That's true. All right.
So you know he's never going to listen back to this. So.
That is also true. All right. So this week's existential question, that's fun to say. Is a hot dog a sandwich? Now, what makes a sandwich, you're asking?
I was not.
Someone out there is.
I thought about it for a second, but I'm like, I think he
Pango
already has.
Pango might be asking.
I feel like he already has that answer lined up, and I'm not going to toss him that softball.
Who?
You.
Me?
Yeah.
No. I was just saying we need to probably set the ground rules for what makes a sandwich.
Piece of meat between two slices of bread.
I mean, but is the bread open-faced or is it closed-faced? Does that mean like a stromboli's a sandwich? Does that mean that a burrito's a sandwich?
I feel like that's what we're about to get into.
Yeah, I think so. Greg, your thoughts?
I mean, technically I'd call it a sandwich. Why not?
Yeah.
It's got bread and meat.
It's an open-faced sandwich then, maybe?
I mean, what's the difference if you're using two end pieces of the bread for a sandwich? Does that all of a sudden make that not a sandwich? Like the two, you know how everybody says ends?
Oh, yeah. Well, I do, but a lot of people throw them away.
I use them.
It's called a butt sandwich.
It's called the heel. The heel of the loaf.
Call it the butt.
Oh. Potato, potato, my friend.
I always like touching the butt.
We are still talking about sandwiches, aren't we?
Yes.
Okay.
I think.
I mean, I think that I think this question could we could literally spend the rest of the podcast on this. What makes a sandwich? You know, does it have to be prepared? Does it have to be? You know what I mean?
Could you
what's
break
the difference
it down?
Between, what's the difference between peanut butter toast and a hot dog? They're both open faced. They both use bread.
Yeah, does it have to be closing meat? It. You're closing the bread around a hot dog.
It's still open face.
You're closing it.
Because the ingredients are right there. You can pluck them out without damaging the bun. You can put toppings on the hot dog without having to open anything.
No, that's not true because I put stuff on the sides so it's not on top of the dog.
On the sides. What?
So you get your hot dog.
Yeah.
You open it up.
I'm with you.
Put stuff on the side. Roll
the
hot dog
to
the other
side. Oh, gotcha.
On the inside.
Okay.
And I eat my hot dog.
I thought you meant like the ends of the hot
dog. Oh, no.
I put a dot of ketchup on this end of the dog and a dot of mustard on the other one.
So the Oxford definition of sandwich is an item of food consisting of two pieces of bread with meat, cheese, or other filling between them, eaten as a light meal.
Okay, so... so the meat, cheese, or other filling, could be anything.
It's a very vague definition.
Between them is a vague definition.
I mean, so then technically then everything that you just listed off, yes, would be considered a sandwich.
Yeah, except for peanut butter toast, unless you folded it. Definitely not pizza.
If you folded it.
If you folded two pieces of pizza, then yes, technically it would be a pizza sandwich.
Or if you took a piece of pizza and put on top of another piece of pizza.
Yeah. Who hasn't done that?
Then you're making a sandwich.
So you are.
The U.S. Department of
Agriculture
describes a sandwich as a meat or poultry filling between two slices of bread, a bun, or a biscuit.
See, I don't like that because that completely rules out peanut butter and jelly sandwich. I don't like the sound of that.
Oxford does say or other filling between them.
I don't take kindly to that, sir. Other filling covers me for a PB&J. That's all I'm concerned with here.
And what?
I could combine those two definitions and just call it good.
Yeah.
Just like call it I would consider a sandwich.
You'd consider a hot dog a sandwich?
Yeah.
You're fucking insane.
That would mean that a brat is a sandwich. That would mean...
why would it be any different?
No, it wouldn't be. Yeah. I just feel like there's a slippery slope from there, Greg.
It is.
Because then everything's a goddamn sandwich. And not everything is a sandwich, Greg.
That's a legitimate point, counterpoint that we're talking about.
You think life is a goddamn sandwich?
Sometimes.
Is that what you think?
I do.
I don't like this. I don't like where this is going.
You guys are going to be down.
Life's a sandwich. What?
Down to two hosts here in a
second. Yeah. Well, okay, that was fun. The one I was going to ask is, what one thing should every human experience at least once in their lives, in your opinion?
One thing that every human should experience?
Every human should experience at least once. Now, you can think about this for a little bit. We can come back to it. But you're going to get one crack at it.
Yeah, let's circle back to that one because that's...
Okay. That was more of a Nick-type question than the hot dog question.
But it would take him 20 minutes to read it.
There would have been a lot of pomp and circumstance around the reading of the question. Yeah. A lot of flipping of pages and scratching of chins and adjectives.
Speaking of which, since he's not here.
Yeah.
Have you ever looked in that book? Is there stuff actually written in there? Or yes. does he just open it?
No, there's actually
like, oh. Look at that. No. Today's existential question.
See, I would do it differently where I would start on page one and I would go and I'd read through all the questions in order. I feel like Nick is cherry picking the questions.
Well, yeah.
I mean, I think you could skip.
I wouldn't cherry pick the questions.
I would, you could skip ones, but I wouldn't go to,
The problem with doing that is that when you're trying to figure out whether you've done a question before, because I know he doesn't keep any records of that. I do. I know he doesn't read them and he doesn't listen back to the show. So any kind of delay, anytime I go like, hey, you got a question for this week? It's always like, yeah, probably. And it's a bunch of frantic like, if he just went page 1 to 100, he'd know exactly where he left off with a fucking bookmark. That'd be that.
Second question to that.
Yeah.
Is it handwritten in there or is that a printed book that he has?
I feel like you're trying to get to a point where you're like saying, I don't think much of these questions that Nick's been asking.
No. you sit on the side. I've never seen in the book. So I don't know if it's just a facade of when he opens it to be like, oh, let me make it look like I have all these questions. When in actuality, he's just coming up with them off the top of his head. And the book is an artifice.
It's just a distraction. It's a show. Yeah.
It's smoke and mirrors. Like, oh, yeah, this is why I need time because I need to flip through this book that has nothing in it.
I will say the first couple of times that he did it, I did sneak a peek because I thought the same thing as you. Like, did you fucking? Because I think I remember he. It was obviously a long time ago, but I think he said, "Yeah, I got this from, from someone in my family, like birthday, Christmas, whatever." And I don't know why, or I don't know how long ago he got it, but
he got a book of questions for Christmas.
Yeah, he didn't say
handwritten questions.
No, it wasn't handwritten.
They're typed out.
They're typed out. It's an actual book.
Oh, so it is typed out.
Yeah, it's an actual book. Okay. But I had the same thought as you. Like, where do you get these questions from? So, yeah, it's legitimate in case anyone out there in the audience was wondering.
I want to know what sociopath in his family found a little leather black book that has no writing on it whatsoever, but has a bunch of existential questions inside of it.
I mean, so I don't think it's any secret. Like when I do the lightning round, which we'll probably get to next, I didn't make up these fucking questions.
No, I know that.
I found a website somewhere this is a good site to use.
Right. But you used a website.
Yeah.
He has a leather bound black book with no writing on it that is filled with these questions.
Yeah.
Like if he was opening up a book that said like the cover when he opened it and I could see across the table and if it said book of existential questions, I'd be like, I get it. That makes sense.
Okay.
But for how do you even go about finding a plain leather bound black book?
I feel like.
Is it embossed with something at all? Like
I didn't look that closely. I was more concerned with what was in it and not what was on the cover because I just assumed that there was a printed typeface inside the book. Only a maniac would have that with nothing on the spine to say the name of the author, the name of the book.
There's nothing. I have seen it plenty of times sitting on his table after we've been cleaning up or whatever.
Now, hold on.
And I know there's no writing on it.
You know that you can go to Barnes & Noble, which still exists and is still open, and you could buy covers for your books. Do you think that he went and he bought a cover to the book so that we wouldn't know where the book came from, so he would maintain some sort of air of secrecy about this?
First of all, that's the only book Nick has touched in probably the last 20 years.
Not a big reader?
So I guarantee he did not know that there was you can buy covers for books. That's not even feasible.
Okay. Well, all I can say is now I'm really going to be super curious. Next weekend, we're definitely doing the existential question.
I want to find out where this book came from.
Yeah, because when he reads a question, I am like staring at the camera. I'm trying to be a good host. I'm trying to engage with the audience, trying to look across through the camera over at you and Greg. But I'm going to fucking turn this way next weekend, and I'm going to be watching him very, very closely.
I think you just ripped the book right out of his hands, and we start getting down to the bottom of this.
Well, that book is not like in a safe where he's got.
That is correct. It's also just sitting next to the table. Yeah,
so I just need to get there on time, and he'll still be like lathering himself up upstairs somewhere. I'll be in the basement taking a look at that book.
And then I think we need to report back.
We will have a report. There will definitely be a time where Nick is going to have to use the lavatory, the show, the little Wrangler's room. And during that time, we will have an update on the existential question book.
The what?
He's a cowboy.
Is he?
He likes to play cowboy.
I can buy.
He's always got.
I can buy a cowboy hat and some boots. You guys wouldn't be calling me a cowboy.
Dude, I almost bought you a cowboy hat. When we were, I was driving down with Krabby down to Dallas for the March Madness trip, and the whole trip was, we would stop at one service station after another, and a lot of them were like truck stop gas stations where there's tons of shit in there. It was like a down south CVS. And truckers go back, they can take a shower, or whatever. But there's aisles for, you know, crazy shit like stuffed animals and cowboy hats. And I almost bought you a hat. I was this close to buying you a hat.
Why?
In fact, because the color of the hat, the shade of the hat, the shape of the hat reminded me of Sam Elliott's hat.
Okay.
In Big Lebowski.
Fair enough.
Yeah. I mean, the dude doesn't wear a hat.
No.
But, I mean, this is pretty close.
All right. I'll give you that.
I couldn't see you wearing it, and it would not be for Lily. I'll expect to see you wearing that. Like, I just impulse buy. Yeah.
Which is also funny of our buddy Nick, that he has all these cowboy hats, yet they only come out at a certain time.
Which is?
After Nick's been drinking.
The cast upstairs at about 3:30 in the morning.
Because and correct me if I'm wrong, but I've never seen our buddy Nick just walking around town or on the old Snapchat driving to work wearing a cowboy hat.
Yeah, that's true. That's a lot of backwards baseball caps.
You get the bathroom selfie with the cowboy hat on.
Yeah,
who gets what?
You don't have Snapchat, so you don't see the Snapchat.
No, who is taking bathroom selfies themselves? Nick is? Nick?
Have you not met our friend Nick?
Yeah, but I'm not privy to what he does on Snapchat, so I was not aware of this.
It's pretty much a daily occurrence.
Every day he takes
every day, but usually every day there's a truck selfie of like, have a good weekend. Weekend's coming.
Yep. Yeah.
Driving down the road.
Yeah.
But occasionally,
you can tell when it's been a real good night because there's three cowboy hats.
What?
There'll be three people there.
I have pictures of all of us in different cowboy
hats. Yeah, oh, okay. Yeah, yeah. Oh, of course.
Well, I'm not saying always us either. There's been some other people that have joined the cowboy festivities.
I guess I didn't realize those hats came out for just anybody. I thought we were special.
Well, I mean, I guess we still kind of are, but.
Doesn't sound like it.
Probably not anymore.
I feel used now. I feel like I'm just fodder for another Snapchat photo.
Usually the case.
Look at my drunk buddies in cowboy hats. We definitely have done that. I've definitely been drunk enough to put that fucking hat on proudly. And I'm sure I looked ridiculous. And I'm sure the pictures were taken and they probably ended up on his Snapchat.
Most likely.
Yeah.
Most likely.
But I did not know that this was a regular occurrence with the cowboy hats.
And like I said, it's got to be after a certain time of the night.
Okay.
So
who is the audience for those pictures?
Do you? Oh, you really want me to answer that?
Yeah. Is there anybody going like, man, when am I going to see the next cowboy hat picture? Are there a lot of cowboys on Snapchat? Is there a big demand on Snapchat for cowboy hat pictures?
You are trying to throw me in this hole, aren't you?
No, I'm legitimately asking. I don't have Snapchat. I've never used Snapchat. That's not true. I use Snapchat. I'm sure I have an ID. When my kids get old enough to get Snapchat, I'm like, I fucking need to get Snapchat now. And I, after like a week or so, I'm like, I don't have time to fuck with this. I guess they're going to post whatever they're going to post. Then that's when you have the conversation with your kids, like, the internet is forever.
Yeah. and know that Snapchat actually keeps track of every picture.
Oh, fuck yeah.
I mean, that you send.
If you think that any application that tells you, like, that is temporary, it is, you, once you delete it, it's gone forever. It's never gone forever. Mm-hmm. I work in the industry that builds the hardware to store all of that shit, and they do, and they back it up, and they replicate it across the country so that in case a tornado ever hits the building, like, your fucking cowboy Snapchat picture, safe as kittens. So who is the audience for these cowboy hat Snapchat pictures?
Same people that made Ram Ranch?
Yeah, I did kind of set him up for that, didn't I? I didn't know that was going to be the answer, but it definitely checked all the boxes.
Sorry.
Yeah. I think it's going to be great because he's going to go like, hey, man, how'd the episode go? And you're like, great, man. No, we killed it. Awesome show. You listen. I'll even tell him, like, you should listen. He won't. He will not listen.
That's all you got to do is just say you should listen, and then he won't.
Yes.
Yeah, don't listen to it. Let's tell him that.
Honestly, because if we say don't listen to it, then he might actually listen to it.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, but I would never say that. In fact, I would probably offer to play it for him, like when he picks me up to take me over to his house for the podcast one night. I should go, oh, you want to listen to a little bit of last week's episode?
Oh, that's
It'll say, no, I'm good.
That's funny. It cut right to 43.
I'll just play the first, like, 10 minutes. That's it.
What could be funny is somebody give it to him for his pick of the week that he has to listen to it.
That's not how Pick of the Week works, sadly.
Yeah, what? You talking about Gentleman's Agreement?
Or Gentleman's Agreement,
and
sorry.
And that's also movies, buddy.
Yeah.
Well, movies are TV, like, but
I... Oh, yeah. I guess, yeah, it's on YouTube.
It's on Spotify, yeah.
There's probably a reason why we haven't done that.
Well, I mean, it wouldn't really make sense for... you a little bit, but I mean, you already listened back to the audio.
Yeah.
I will
voluntarily go and watch every now and again. So,
and me, it would definitely make no sense because I'm already rewatching it when I'm doing the editing. So, right. I go fuck yourself. I'm not watching it again after I've watched it. I lived it and then I watched
If you're smart, you'll say, okay. And then you get the week off from Gentleman's Agreement.
Very true.
Yeah. Okay. Well,
that's, you know, it's a thought.
All right. You guys hold down the fort for a second because we're like 45 minutes in and have had no shots yet. Even though Greg's been drinking, let's do what are we drinking? Greg, what do you got?
I got another 17-year Belvedere Scotch.
Okay, with some fantastic homegrown ice balls.
Ice balls.
Yes.
I borrowed your glass, though.
That's no problem. You can use my glass, put your own balls in that glass.
Perfect.
Corey, what do you got?
Believe it or not, same thing as always.
All right.
Still with the hard soda.
I got a Beta Straw Gator, which is strawberry Doppelbach, which is not too shabby. Impulse buy. But worth it.
That happens.
Strawberry?
Yeah.
Straw Gator.
Yeah. Well, speaking of which, that's what you didn't grab when you were over there getting all the equipment.
No, I didn't. And honestly, it was probably because in my head, last Saturday night after the podcast was a blur, and I didn't want to repeat that.
Fair enough.
Like, the whole next day was just a complete waste for me. I think I spent the entire day. Yeah, because it was Sunday. You guys normally have Monday off.
Right? Well, luckily this was my first Monday off, so that's why I was able to do it on a Sunday night.
Okay, this was I don't ever have Monday off, because I had already worked all day, all night. Saturday night and Sunday.
You were able to take Monday off.
Yeah, go ahead and take it off. I'm like, sweet. So we're all like, you know, when you find out you got an actual work day off, you're like, glug. And it was like three different kinds of whiskey we were drinking. It was just a horrible idea. But
that's why I didn't go.
So excited.
Like, no, that's going to be bad. I
spent
the
whole next day in the bed trying to sleep it off. It was rough.
Yeah, I had to be up at like 6 o'clock. So I'm like, I can't make it. I'll be literally leaving next to go to work.
Best idea you ever had. If I had to get up at 6, I don't know, I wouldn't drink at all. There'd be no point.
We usually go up to scoreboard, have a couple beers and quick dinner, and I'm usually home and in bed by like 10:30, quarter to 11.
I remember going to the bar with you years ago, Joe, and then we would see you up there, and a few other people. It was back at like JP's days, and I remember thinking to myself, like, nights like those were, you know, everybody was drinking. We'd take turns buying rounds of shots, and you know, it was. You would try to keep up with everybody, like, another round, like, yep, of course I'm in. And then, you know, it would kind of come to you again. And you're like, oh, I guess I get, yeah, it's my turn. I got to buy a round. And by the time the night was over, you're like, oh man, just not in a good place. But you did it all completely voluntarily, mm-hmm. right? You were just playing, let's keep up with the Joneses.
Man, that was so but now stupid we're, of us.
But now I look back on that because now we're doing a podcast where every weekend we're doing that, but it's like a
at somebody's house.
It's at somebody's house, and it's to a cadence where it's like clockwork, like start with the drink and then with the shot, and then we talk 10 minutes and then we do another shot, and then we talk another 15 minutes and we do another shot, and we take a break and then we come back, we do a shot. Like at the every week we do the same thing. And then the only variable is after the episode's over, we go upstairs for the after party, like how hard do we hit it then? And it's usually like just as hard, if not harder, than we hit it in the show.
It's usually harder because Nick, for some reason, feels the need to pour shots every
he's a shot
7.5 minutes or so.
Yeah, especially when he has alcohol that he doesn't prefer and wants to give it all away to his friend.
Yeah. So now I look back in those days at JP's going, like, that was nothing. That was nothing.
It's not that it was nothing.
It was so easy to just go like, "Nah, I'm out this round, fellas."
Was it though?
Yeah,
I guess maybe for you.
Well, at the time we didn't. That's true.
Honestly, because at the time I remember spending
fair enough
way too much money on a Tuesday night. It's like, oh, 60 bucks God. Just because we wanted to do shots. That's fantastic.
I remember doing that and then having to get up and work on a Wednesday morning.
Because we used
to. Now I can't imagine that.
On Tuesdays, we'd go to Bailey's, start drinking there, run over to Howell's, do shots at Howell's because it was a third of the price.
Yes.
And then we'd run back over to Bailey's.
That's Howell's was probably the only place that, like, we would, I could go to town on shots and get my tab, and it was like, oh, $13.
Yep.
Like, wow, that's pretty crazy considering I just bought six rounds of shots for everyone. But which I so it, and as you know, like, Howell's was the first place I went to when I turned 21. It was kind of the normal go to, and then we would go to other places where
they way more they charged weren't for everything,
where they weren't pervy to my Howell's.
Pervy?
Yeah,
pervy,
privy,
no, pervy,
pervy, because he's perverted.
To my Howell's status, and when I would buy rounds of shots, they would charge me full price, and I would get the bill. I'm like, holy shit! I'm like, what is that?
Oh yeah, I was kind of bummed that we're not at Nick's because I was going to bring them over. I have a pitcher from Howell's that I was going to bring to the house so they can fill up off the keg and take it upstairs. We were cleaning out some cabinets at the house and. Why do you have a pitcher up there? I'm like, that's from Howell's. One night, you know how it was. It's gone, so whatever. It'd be like 3:30 in the morning. They're like, all right, now it's time for you to leave.
Well, yeah, because
we wanted to go home.
Because at last call, they would always.
Well, they didn't do last call till 10 after.
Well,
10-2.
Right. But at the same turnaround, they'd tell you last call, but last call just basically meant order as much now as you can handle. And we'll stay here until you drink it.
Yeah.
But we have to get it. We have to purchase it now and get it out to you now. We can't give it to you at 3 a.m.
And that was one of those things where we ordered two pitchers right away. And it's like, there's a lot of people there. And usually they would let us stay after. And be, like I said, 3:30, 4 o'clock before you left. Well, there's a whole bunch of people. We're like, well, let's just get out of here. Let's not be those people this time. So I took the picture. I forgot who was working. And I was just like under my jacket. And I walked out like this. I probably could have walked out of there like this with it. And they wouldn't have said anything.
I'm sure.
But I put it behind my, you know, underneath my coat. And I walked away. And I'm like walking down the street drinking.
Oh, man, the Howells days.
All right, we got a shot sitting here. I didn't pour you one, Greg, because generally when you're drinking the scotch. Okay, so this is the lime basil vodka from Pearl.
Oh, boy.
That will give it a shot. Oh, yeah, that's Fireball, Corey.
So no, I told you I'm going
to
try it.
Okay, so here we go. Here's to you.
Not bad.
Yeah.
Definitely taste the basil.
Yeah, but it's not bad.
No.
With the lime, I was worried about the basil.
I don't dislike it. I don't see it being, that's kind of a one and done for me.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's got a good flavor to it.
Right.
But it's not something, it's minty.
A little bit.
Yeah, the one's good, but I couldn't see being like, oh, I'll pour another one of those.
I might try doing like a martini.
I was going to say, a mixed drink is probably the way to go with that.
Not even a mixed drink. I mean, it'd be a straight up martini with maybe some blue cheese olives.
Oh, well, yeah, sorry.
But it'd be cold. It'd be really cold.
Oh, you got to chill the shit out of that.
Yeah. Now, it's been in the freezer for a week. So that's probably as cold as it's going to get, but if you shake it around with the ice, it'll drop it a little bit more.
You know, not terrible.
Yeah. Definitely do it again. Sorry. It's the basil.
Not terrible, huh?
It's the basil. That's what I'm blaming on anyway.
Always the goddamn basil. Now, if we were to put that in between two slices of bread and eat it, we got ourselves
not a sandwich.
We got ourselves a sandwich.
All right, let's do a little, let's have a shot. Love a shot, and then we'll do a little gentleman's agreement. So if you've got something, raise it up. If not, pour yourself something. You can pause this. And we're back.
Oh, hey.
Here's to you. Oh, ho, ho.
As Todd would say, holy shit. That was a good shot.
If he said something, it would include the words mighty or...
I wasn't going to fall into his trap.
Great sassy molassy or something like that. All right.
I was thinking the Machu Picchu.
But, yeah. Well, Nick kind of claimed that last week. I'm not sure if he's going to continuously week after week lay claim to it or not. But
to Machu Picchu?
Yeah.
You can't lay claim to that. That's Todd's.
Well, I just laid claim to his existential question, so...
Well, you didn't lay claim to it. We just took over the segment since he's not here.
Well, we'll see what happens next week.
Then discussed his creepy little black book.
Yes, we did. All right, here we go.
Oh, it's the MF and gentleman's agreement. Oh, done.
All right, gentlemen of the agreement. Greg, it was back in the 9th. You had, I'm not sure from who, Holy Heist?
For me.
Oh, yeah. That does sound like a Corey documentary.
Yes.
That is a quintessential Corey documentary name. Holy Heist.
Yes. It is about a heist of about $7 million. I know, right? Crazy.
Holy Heist.
I believe there's a priest and possibly a police officer that might have killed somebody. There's a lot going on.
Wait, did you actually watch this?
I did.
Okay.
Yesterday. The problem
that sounds
was,
like the sketchy review of someone who didn't watch their movie.
No.
I'm not sure.
The issue was that he assigned me Heist.
It was back in the, a couple, the 9th. Yeah.
A couple weeks ago.
Yeah.
And I just kept thinking, I'm like, I know what's going to happen because it's a heist. It's a show about a heist. And I'm just like, I was watching it, but I was kind of zoning in and out of it. And I'm just like, I can't get into it. Like, I watched it. I mean, it was like, okay, whatever. The priest was the funniest.
That's a great review.
It was okay, whatever.
I mean, if you're into documentaries and you're into heists, if you like hearing about those.
Yeah, that's right up your laneway.
The funniest part was the priest, because there may have been a priest that was involved with hiding some of the money.
Okay.
But you wouldn't think, because it's a priest.
Yeah.
But this priest seemed pretty dirty to me.
What are your thoughts?
Well, and obviously, yes, I'm biased towards the documentary, so I give you
I have to watch, like, I have to be in the mood
Yep.
And find something I really want to watch a documentary. Not just like...
I hear you and identify with that.
Yeah.
And it's always hard to watch a gentleman's agreement assignment that you've not heard of before and might not fall into your specific yep. likes.
Yeah.
You know, but you got to fucking...
And I watched it. I mean, I did. I watched okay. it last night, yesterday.
Okay.
It was yesterday.
So it's fresh.
Yes.
All right. Your review doesn't sound...
No.
doesn't sound like it's fresh to me.
No, and again,
there was a lot going on with the people that were involved in the heist.
There was a lot going on with the people that were
no,
there.
No, there's different so, ties.
Yeah.
So to me, one of the craziest parts, and for some reason, I can now pick up on trends on new documentaries that I watch because I've seen so many.
You're a student of the game, sir.
Dude, I might go back to school and... become some sort of professor in yeah. documentaries.
Excuse me, I might go to school. yeah.
But like the newest trend of what these new documentaries are doing, it, like, so they'll talk about the situation and they'll have like interview some people that know about it, you know, that kind of had a tie of a friend that they knew that was part of it. So you're like, okay, like obviously, yeah, these are all people that knew someone that was part of it. Mm-hmm. And then like 30 minutes in, they dropped the bomb of like, they have the actual person that was like the centerpiece of this documentary. And you're like, holy shit, hang on. If there was a bank robbery and this priest was hiding money, how is he currently not in jail? And they're interviewing him for yeah. this documentary. And he blatantly admitted in the documentary, he's like, yeah.
He's like,
there might have been some money somewhere.
He's like, there might have been some money. He goes, but I'll tell you right now, if I did have it, I wouldn't tell you.
Yeah. Yeah. So
he goes, and it was all in
20s. Isn't that where the cops come in, though?
Well, that was a thing. He goes, and it was all in 20s. They stole money. It was all in $20 bills. And he's like, that's easy to spread around town.
All right.
So, yeah. So, like, the fact that they have the actual person that was that deep in it, not like a friend of a friend that did it.
Yeah.
Like it was the actual, like one of the people involved that you would think at this point would be completely locked up and yeah. thrown away for the rest of time.
And there was a cop involved as well.
Yeah.
I do believe they think they killed the main, he killed the main guy that was involved with the robbery. He's like, you don't got a body. He's like, actually we do. He's like, we found the body.
I don't think you're I said you don't have a body.
Yeah. And he's like, and the cop was like, I don't want to talk to you anymore.
Okay.
But I mean, like I said, it's one of those things that I watch them, but if it's something, it's a heist.
Right.
I did double down on you pretty hard with the two back-to-back heist movies. So
yeah,
I'm a sucker for heist flicks.
Oh, see, and that's the thing. Again, everyone's...
I feel like that has a different flavor. His list to give to me, but he gave it to
you
instead.
Do you watch Rick and Morty at all?
No.
No? Okay.
I don't. But I have been told many, many times.
There's an episode that they talk about heists, and Rick just belittles everything about heist movies. He's like, I'll show you how it goes in the whole episode. I mean, it was hilarious.
Yeah.
But that's...
Well, look, dude, if you're keeping a list, and I know you're not, Rick and Morty is a great assignment to give to me because I've never seen it.
I'll have to do that one of these days.
Of course. Like, all right, sir. Excellent review.
It's hard to say because, like I said, it's
That's more than fine.
Yeah, I mean, it involved a cop, a boxer, and then a priest. So like okay. these three people, you're like, oh,
it's like the beginning of a bad joke.
Yeah, exactly. Right. They walk into a bar.
A cop, a priest, and a boxer walking into a bar.
Yeah, I mean, they get involved yeah. too. They kind of bounced around a little bit too. I mean, they talk about the, what was that, the IRA over there. And like okay. this priest has ties to this group. And
yeah,
it was just like, what the fuck?
I mean, I would say that, yeah, if you're really into that kind of stuff, like
yeah.
especially documentaries, I think it's a solid choice. But if you're not, then yeah, I wouldn't watch. I wouldn't have been 2 minutes into it before I turned it off. But
yeah, I'd have scrolled right past it. But I watch it.
Fair enough. And if you can finish that joke, a cop and a boxer and a priest walk into a bar, email us at schnozcast@gmail.com, or you could text us at 618-SHOCKER.
Which Nick probably has on him right now.
But the more importantly, a week from now, when we do the next episode, we will read your joke on the air.
Goddamn good joke.
Well, yeah, that's the challenge, right? So I'm talking to all the people across the world who supposedly are downloading us, because I know that you're out there and you want to remain anonymous for some reason. Don't do that shit. Send us an email. Make a fake email address on Gmail. Just to send us one email. Yeah. Just to send us one email. I mean, look, I don't know if you know this, but the new version of iOS has a hide my email feature.
Yeah. Yes. Oh, I'm very aware of it. I use it all the time.
I just started using it, and it's the greatest thing ever. So if you want to send an email to somebody, or if you're responding to an email about, like, hey, I want to buy this shit from Wayfair.com, but I don't want all of the fucking Wayfair.
Dude, my inbox has gone down so far.
Yeah.
So
I can't wait.
I would wake up to 109 emails just in the morning.
Yeah.
Just of basically all spam.
All dog shit, yeah.
And now since I've been using the hide my email address, I might wake up to like 27.
Yeah. Yeah. And if it gets too big, you just fucking kill that email address and you make another one.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
No, that's it. That's the genius of hide my email. You can make as many as you want and they'll all forward to your address. But once one of them starts
I see.
Then you
okay,
just fucking kill it, delete it, and make a new one. And they'll all keep forwarding to your...
Yeah,
so that's your IT. That's your IT gem for the week. Yeah. All right. Corey, you had to watch Prison Break from Nick.
From Rick, yeah. Something that he's actually seen that I have not.
Yeah, I couldn't believe it when he said it. It was like his first thing, too. He's like, well, you got Prison Break. He seemed very sure that you hadn't seen it.
He was very confident about it that I had not seen Prison Break.
I couldn't believe it, too, when you were like, I have not.
There's a reason why, because not many people have seen Prison Break, because it's...
So start at the beginning. Start at the beginning. What's it about?
So Prison Break is basically a sitcom.
Sitcom?
No,
it's a rollicking adventure.
It's not a sitcom. I wouldn't even know what genre to really put
it in. If there was a laugh track on that show, that'd be the first thing you would have said.
Oh, if there was a laugh track, I wouldn't have made it as far as I did in watching all the episodes.
Yeah. By the way, Hollywood, if you're paying attention, make a show called Prison Something and put a laugh track on it, because that would be hilarious.
And no one will ever watch it. The opening of it was very... a little strange. It didn't give you much information at first. The pilot episode didn't give you much information. But what it boils down to, and this is an older show. I don't feel bad giving any spoilers. But a guy gets basically sent to prison, to rescue his brother that's been put on death row. And he believes his brother is innocent. His brother obviously believes that, and he's there to break him out of prison and prove that he's innocent. Now I will say I see why Nick assigned it to me, because it is exactly along like the exact same lines as Burn Notice that I gave him.
Oh, really?
It's there's some very hokey moments.
By the way, sorry to sidetrack you, but I have heard from Nick within the last couple of weeks.
He's still watching Burn Notice.
Yeah, Burn Notice is his go-to.
When I started rewatching it, I'm like, oh my god! I'm like, I watched this like 5 years ago. This has Nick written all over it, and I don't know why it didn't come to mind sooner than that.
I have never seen it, but I have seen the Saturday Night Live sketch lampooning what the fuck is Burn Notice? Dude, over and over again, they would show clips of the show, and then just people coming and going, what is the show? I don't get it.
I mean, anyone that's seen Archer.
I've also never seen Archer. No.
So Archer.
No, I haven't.
Archer's basically a...
You just got two shows that you could assign to me if you want.
Archer's a cartoonized version of Burn Notice, basically. And it's just making fun of it's just making fun of the entire show.
Okay.
It's literally the show itself.
Archer is phenomenal.
I don't know if anyone else would say that Burn Notice was phenomenal.
No. I wouldn't expect anyone to.
Yeah.
And that's where like Prison Break kind of falls for me is like, it's not phenomenal. I mean, I watched, I think I'm like on episode 7 or something of the first season
of,
I think 5 seasons.
Prison Break, right?
Yeah.
Oh, Prison Break. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. We're going back to.
Oh no. Burn Notice. I've watched through gotcha. Like twice.
All right.
But Prison Break, it's very similar to Burn Notice as far as the acting and scenes and all that. But it's more to me of like a background kind of thing. Like if I just need something to watch or turn on.
Yeah.
Prison Break will do it for you. It's
okay.
I mean, there's some things like you
I totally I see where you're coming from.
You do need to catch, cause like, unlike Burn Notice, and I think that's one of the reasons why Nick likes Burn Notice so much is because you can start an episode and finish it and literally like jump to just about any other episode and it's brand new from the beginning.
They're all like, self-contained.
They're all self-contained episodes.
You don't need to watch episode 1 to understand episode 7 of a season.
I mean, you do, but you don't, if that makes any sense.
No, like, it doesn't.
Well, because you don't have to watch them all in an exact row. Like if you were to go into season 1 and watch like the first 2 episodes and then go to season 5, you're gonna miss out on a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
But if you were in season 1 and you watched episode 1 or the pilot episode and then went to like episode 3, you'd be like, oh, okay, I get it. Like that, I didn't miss out on much.
Okay. So you could skip probably like 5 or 6 episodes in the same season.
I wouldn't say 5 or 6. Maybe 3 or 4? Maybe 2 or 3.
2 or 3? Okay.
Prison Break,
that's more of a serialized.
I was going to say it was a running TV show of like every week.
I remember when Prison Break came out. I never watched it, but I remember it got a lot of press. It was a Fox show, right?
Yeah, it has no one in it.
Well, that was a big draw to it, though.
That's not true. The guy.
Witterford, whatever his first name. He's got a crazy first name.
No, I
got
to look it up, but I want to say one of the lead 2 characters went on to be like a main villain in like Iron Man 3.
No.
You sure? I could be wrong about that. I don't mean to derail the view here.
You're fine. Because there was only one person from the cast that I kind of, Wentworth Miller is the main.
That's
he's the main character.
So he's been a bad guy in Iron Man 3. He's been in a ton of shit.
He
was in Band of Brothers. He's been in a ton of shit.
Yeah, but nobody really knows. Band of Brothers was great.
Band of Brothers was great, and it had a ton of actors who had not made it big yet.
Yeah.
And he was one of those guys.
Okay, yeah, I guess he is. He's DC Legends of Tomorrow. Okay.
Yeah, but apart from that guy, I'm with you. It was a cast of nobodies.
And as a matter of fact, I noticed the one inmate, Fernando was his name in the show. But
Fernando.
Do that, please. Amari.
How to derail a gentleman's agree review in 1 second.
Amari Nolasco. He.
Gesundheit.
By name, yeah, you're not going to recognize him. But by face, the second I saw him, I'm like, oh my God, I've seen him in everything. Mm-hmm. Which, again.
I love guys like that.
Yeah, they just kind of.
The fact that I didn't know, that I don't know his name, but I've seen him in everything and I recognize his face, that's a credit to him as an actor. Right?
Yeah. Very, that's
he's
very
got a name that doesn't make the press that you don't know, but you go like, that dude is the shit because he did a great job. This other show I saw him in, this other movie he was in, that's acting. Those guys are like character actors and
they're very, very, very much so character actors. Yeah. I recognized him, but again, he's still not a big name, but that's that correlation to Burn Notice as well. Like Bruce Campbell was the only name I knew in Burn Notice.
Right. That's me too.
I
love Bruce Campbell, but I still never watched Burn Notice.
And
which speaks to how shitty I heard the reviews on Burn Notice were.
Oh, dude, now you made this pick really tough for me today. I'm so sorry.
I have made your entire day tough.
Yeah.
I have.
As a matter of fact, too,
I'm really sorry. It's not intentional.
When you were on the phone with me earlier, I was about to be like, dude, you're heading out here now.
To what?
To the shower earlier.
Oh, dude, I've done that already. I've been a cowboy in that rodeo. I don't need to do it again.
As the best man was what I was going
to
call.
Best men don't go to fucking wedding showers.
If I call on you,
that's how it is now. Yeah,
you know, you're welcome. You're welcome that I did not.
If you had called on me, I would have been there, 100%.
I figured this much, but I did not. So you're welcome. Anyways, back to the original point.
Yep. Yep.
So if you need, you just have nothing else to watch, and you're like, oh,
that's a glowing review.
I want it, and no, because it's wrote me in, you know, and I do want to see the outcome of
the fact that you're still watching it is a big
yeah. But like I say, it's not something I'm going to sit down and just like dedicate my time to,
right?
And be like, oh, okay, I need to watch.
I'm quitting my job, and I'm going to watch Prison Break full time now.
I'm not going to watch the next five episodes, you know, tomorrow on my day off. Like if Danielle happens to go to bed, and I'm like, oh, I got nothing to do, then I'll put an episode or two on.
Okay,
so a solid pick. I'll give Nick that.
Gotcha. All right, so that I'll wrap it up with the thing about Pam, which Todd assigned to me. So the thing about Pam is on Hulu. If you're bored and you're looking for some shit to watch, check out the thing about Pam on Hulu. It is the true story of this woman who was murdered, and her best friend is this woman named Pam, and Pam is played by the only name in the whole show that eclipses every other name. It's Renee Zellweger is playing Pam underneath like a ton of, like, think about Colin Farrell in Batman. Mm. That's Renee Zellweger playing Pam. Ton of prosthetics. So I ended up watching the entire show. It was 8 episodes, I think, like 40 minutes each. And I fucking got suckered into watching all of them. And the reason why was because I didn't realize until I watched this show how much I don't like Renee Zellweger. I've made no secret about the fact that there are actors and actresses who I will not watch. Jessica, who's Matthew Broderick's wife?
Jessica Sarah Parker.
Sarah Jessica Parker.
Jessica Sarah Parker.
Horse face.
She's got this goddamn bowling ball eyes, and I can't watch her. Renee Zellweger's got this fucking crazy mouth that the lips that move at like angles that lips shouldn't move at. And I can't tell whether she's doing it on purpose or whether she just fucking talks like that, but it's annoying as all get out. It's a testament to Tom Cruise's performance in Jerry Maguire that I still like that movie, despite the fact that she's in that movie 50% of the time and I have to watch her. And I really realized that I do not like Renee Zellweger. I can't watch her. Doesn't mean she's not a great actress, but something about her just rubs me the wrong way. As the friend of the woman who got murdered, it comes into play that she's kind of shady, to quote you from earlier in the show, Greg. And they're trying to figure out who killed this woman. But everybody in the show, everybody in this small town, is an idiot. And they don't understand, and they can't see that Pam is full of shit. But it's very apparent to the viewer from the first episode. So I watched all 8 episodes waiting for someone to call this shitty, shitty actress out on her shitty, shitty bullshit and arrest her for what she clearly did that was, you know, when you're watching a heist film, to take it back to your review, Greg, when you're watching a heist film, at least string me along and give me the shadow of a doubt that the guy that I think clearly did it might not have done it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because if there's someone who from episode 1 clearly did it, and then it turns out that by the end of the 8th episode, they absolutely fucking did it, you just wasted my time. And that's kind of all this was a waste of my time.
And no suspense, no buildup. No. There,
all it was waiting for this goddamn bitch to get her comeuppance. And at the end of it, I can't even say I got that. I think
we're still stuck on the comeuppance.
It's a fucking, what? It's a word. It's a word. So to put it in Todd Dylan terms, I would give this a D-.
Oof.
And maybe he was swinging for the fences. Maybe he thought that I was a fan of Renee Zellweger. Maybe he thought...
Oh, he was clearly wrong on that.
Maybe he thought she did a great job acting. I don't know what it is. I'll have to talk to him next week.
Maybe he didn't realize who it was because of all the...
I mean, maybe. But I know he's I know he's seen Jerry Maguire. It's a football movie, dude. I know he's seen it. So I can't say why. But I was in until the end, hoping that I would get the payoff that I waited for, and I really didn't get it. And that pissed me off at the end, and that's why I'm giving it a D minus.
All right.
So if you love Renee Zellweger, this is the show for you. Drop everything and watch the show immediately. If you love small town murder mysteries where everybody's a ignorant jackass and no one understands what a clue is, this is the show for you.
I feel like you're definitely going to be in the minority of people that don't like Renee Zellweger that much.
I am totally fine with that.
I'm not saying it's a bad thing.
If I was like, I'm going to sleep just fine tonight. I just,
when you lose not 1 minute of
sleep. When you make the statement of, oh, if you really hate Renee Zellweger.
It's the show for you. Yeah.
No, if you hate her, though, not to watch it. Which I don't think there's.
Yeah, that's true. So, if you hate her, don't watch it because you're not going to be satisfied at the end. If you love her, probably your number one new favorite show. So, with that, new assignments. Let me just talk about this real quick. Generally, it is not a fallacy that we. Some people think that we just go like, oh, on the break we'll figure out. Oh, I'll take you and you take him and. You know, that's how we do the assignments. No, I literally have a Excel worksheet with a randomized formula that spits that shit out. And we don't need to go deep into that. But I will say that tonight we're doing something a little bit different because there's only three of us here. And it's easier just to look at who got assigned something from who when. And, I don't need to assign Corey something to watch. When I just did last week. So we've already kind of figured this out. So I have Greg. Greg has Corey, and Corey has me. So I will kick it off. Greg.
Yes.
I'm going to kind of go through a couple that there's a pretty good chance you've already seen before, but it's going to allow me to take them out of my list and pare it down a little bit. So have you seen Repo Man?
Yes. So there's two. There's like
the original. Fuck the other one.
Okay. I was making sure.
So yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, because there's
I'm a purist.
Okay, that's fair.
Yeah. Have you seen The Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai?
Oh, I don't know if I've seen that.
I can already tell you haven't, that's for sure.
No. This is totally down Greg's alley. While you're looking that up, how about have you seen Apostle?
I think I've seen that one. I haven't seen the Banzai. I don't think I have.
Okay, but Apostle is kind of a horror movie.
I don't know. There's no giving him pick of the choice.
Well, I'm just saying.
Choice that's... pick. Pick of the litter. Pick of the litter. That's a good documentary for you right there. Pick of the litter.
What's a girl doing like you in this neck of the wape?
Neck of the woods.
Babe of the woods. Why are you here?
Here's a check for.
Have you seen Fletch?
Yeah, seen Fletch.
All right.
I have not seen Buckaroo Banzai, so I will watch that.
Let's do that. But while you're looking shit up, look up Apostle. And tell me.
I don't think I've seen that. I just saw it there on Netflix.
I'm kind of surprised you haven't seen that, actually. I put it in here going, like, there's no fucking way Greg hasn't seen this.
There's a solid chance that I start watching it about 15 to 20 minutes in. I'm like, yep, I've seen this. Because I do that all the time.
Okay. You got Adventures of Buckaroo Banzai. And I feel like Corey's super happy that I didn't assign that movie to him just by name alone.
Oh, yeah.
All right. So, Greg.
Yes.
What do you got for Corey?
Have you seen Red Notice?
Yes.
I got to figure it out. I had to ask.
You want me to move on to?
No, I got a couple here. I was looking at stuff at the break.
Yeah. Okay.
The Conversations with a Killer, the John Wayne Gacy tapes.
Yeah.
And then there's the Ted Bundy one.
Come on, dude. Oh. Now you're just going back.
They're new.
Now you're just going backwards.
They're both new, so.
I watched the Gacy one the first night it came out.
Shocker.
All right, do you want me to move to Corey?
While
you...
Yeah, go to Corey for a second. All right,
Corey, we got one.
Bob, you have Drunk, Stoned, Brilliant, Dead.
Seen it.
You fuckface. God damn
it. I'm a huge Lampoon fan.
I know, dude. I was watching it the other night.
There was another one that you asked me about that was very similar to that. Or maybe it was a Too Funny to Fail.
Too Funny.
Yeah, I just happened to.
No, Too Funny because you had to watch.
Yeah.
Mm, that hurts, buddy. That hurts. All right, you got Winning Time.
Winning Time?
On HBO.
Jimmy Savile, the British Horror Story.
No.
Oh, what? Sorry. This is your pick for him?
Yep.
Okay. So what is it called?
Jimmy Savile.
Spell
British,
Savile.
S-A-V-I-L-E. A British Horror Story. It's on a little two-parter on Netflix there.
Oh, it's on Netflix? Okay. Got it.
I saw a preview for it. I was like, well, let's watch that.
All right. I think we're good then. Corey, how many minutes are we left in the...
126.
126? Okay. Let's do a little lightning round, and then we'll close it out with Pick of the Week. All right, so we've already done existential question for this episode, which is generally one question that provokes some, you know, deeper amount of discussion. Lightning round is a little bit different than that. It's questions where it's generally a very short answer, but sometimes can foster some discussion. So, and I would never stop that from happening. So, so we'll just start with this one. And again, this is to the group. So for a question, what is the lamest dessert that people try to pass off as a dessert?
Rice pudding.
Corey Selesky, ladies and gentlemen.
Pretzel Jell-O.
Pretzel Jell-O? What the fuck is that?
Oh,
you love pretzel Jell-O?
I don't know. No.
I don't even know. Explain to me what pretzel Jell-O is.
It's literally what it sounds like.
Jell-O with pretzels in it?
Yeah.
Kinda. It's this... My family does it every year. I just like, I'm like, get the... I have a cousin that absolutely loves it. He eats like the whole pan of it.
Yeah.
No.
Just no. So rice pudding, pretzel Jell-O.
Well, wouldn't it just be all puddings then?
No. But banana fucking pudding? Have you ever had goddamn banana pudding?
Yes. This is what I...
No, I'm allergic to bananas. Like, this is a delicious discussion.
Then your life sucks, sir. I'm sorry for that. That is all.
Wow. Okay. I'm going to say whatever the marshmallow fluff bullshit is that people serve. Is that fall into the...
No, hang on.
That's more of a topping.
Yeah.
No. I've seen people serve like a goddamn giant... bowl full of marshmallow fluff shit.
No one's done that.
No, they have. There may be some other shit that they threw
like
in it.
Fruit in there and stuff
yes,
like that.
Yeah.
And they're in prison because they're a psychopath that's killed 25 people.
I'm agreeing with you.
No one just serves a bowl of fluff. And if they do, fucking run. Run.
I ran as far as I could.
Lori's still upstairs.
It was not Lori.
Okay.
And if it was, I would tell you, maybe off camera. all right. When you fly in a plane, do you wear a neck pillow?
No.
Are you some kind of goddamn savage? How do you sleep in a plane? Do you not sleep in a plane?
Not usually.
No?
No, I like to make people nervous around me.
That would make me nervous. You had no neck pillow and you're just like, so. What movie are we watching tonight? Can I share your headphones? You take the left and I'll take the right. I have a splitter. You can blow yours into mine.
I bring a book or I watch a movie, typically. Okay.
But you'd never... Have you ever been in a flight long enough where you really should probably go to sleep?
Vegas is what, 4 hours? 3.5, 4 hours? That's...
More like 5, I thought.
It's like 3 or 4. 3.5 or 4 hours flight.
To Vegas?
Yeah, I think it's 4 hours. That's okay. Literally like there in Florida, probably the two.
Yeah.
I mean,
but Vegas is a red eye flight too. So, but you're not sleeping on that flight. You're
not usually. I mean, I can sleep without a
neck pillow.
What yeah, you, like my head is in your, the back of the
your
chair.
Coat. Oh, because you're tall. Oh, you goddamn son of a bitch.
It's usually more like this.
Corey, though. What do you got to say it's about like that? This. Go fuck yourself in your tall neck.
I say I'm the complete opposite of that, and I sit a little shorter in the chair.
Corey brings two neck pillows.
No, but you know what? I've never traveled with one.
No.
If I have like a sweatshirt on or something, like I'll take that off and mm-hmm. might bunch it up behind my neck.
It's cold in the plane.
It can. Dude, it can never be cold enough on a plane. You're sitting scrunched up next to everyone. I'm running hot. I'm running hot on a plane.
Do you really?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Do you run hot in bed normally?
For the most part, I run hot pretty much all day long. But
okay.
On a plane, yeah. There's that. It's yeah. definitely, I don't care what time of the year it is here in Michigan when we're leaving, I'm wearing shorts.
Now, does Danielle run cold on a plane?
You know what's funny, bud? This will be the first time, our honeymoon will be the first time we've ever flown on a plane together. Yeah.
Wow, that's fantastic. I did not know that. I'm super excited for you guys.
First time we've ever traveled anywhere that we've needed to fly to.
It is probably the closest you're going to come to building a house together. When you land, that marriage is going to either be stronger than ever or you guys are going to be fucking done.
I'm sure we'll be all right.
All right. This is actually more of an existential one. Who inspires you? Don't say Nick Bader.
I was going to say Todd Dillon, but
that's fine.
That's
his name's not Nick Bader.
Okay. That's hard to narrow down to just one person.
I feel you. And yet you must pick someone.
Jeffrey Lebowski.
Okay. I had in mind an actual person, living person.
Oh, that one.
But I'll allow it. I'll allow it.
Thanks.
Greg, any fictitious characters that it's
been? We'll go Randall from Clerks.
Wow. Okay. Now I need to rethink my answer because I have to come up with someone who wasn't a real person.
I would still go with that and say Jeff Bridges as.
Yeah, that's a better answer. He's alive as we speak.
Oh, yeah. But
at the moment.
I mean, I feel like his persona is not actually too far off from the dude.
Yeah, that's probably pretty true.
So,
and they gave him a lot of license in that movie to do what he does. Wow. I guess I would have to say if it's a real person, I'd probably say my sister Becky, just because of, you know, the amount of, she's the complete opposite of me. She works really fucking hard all the time, like nonstop hard. She'd never be caught doing anything as stupid as this podcast. She never. She thinks it's great, but that's just because she's a good person and is supportive. And you know, she's a middle child, so she kind of took all the shit that a middle child does, and it made her tougher as a result. And I could say this because I know she'll never listen to this. So I don't need to worry about her getting a big head or, so that'd be my, and if it was a fake person, I'd pick Silent Bob. I'd pick Kevin Smith.
All right. Speak only when you need to.
Yeah. Yeah. When people least expect it.
Yeah.
And your words have so much more weight as a result. Corey, how do you feel about cranberries?
Gross. Disgusting.
Greg?
I'm with Corey.
Yeah?
Yeah.
So every Thanksgiving, I assume there's cranberry sauce.
Sure.
Served. Do you never eat it?
Nope.
Corey?
God, no. No. Never.
Okay. how is that cranberry sauce served? Is it served in a bowl?
Don't know. Don't even look at it.
Or do they take a can of it and empty the can of the plate that you slice off with a knife?
Because
I maintain that that shit is delicious.
I've seen it both ways. Won't touch either.
Cranberry sauce, slicing off a piece of a can-shaped cranberry gelatin. Log. Unbelievable. It is the hallmark of the thing. The one thing on Thanksgiving I look forward to the most.
But my plate has no room for that.
And I literally could buy it potatoes, any day of the year.
Stuffing.
And keep it in my fridge all year long. But I don't. I have it on Thanksgiving.
I now think less of you.
I am not surprised.
I had one traumatic experience with that canned cranberry shit.
Go on.
My parents made me try it. I wasn't allowed to leave the dinner table until I tried it, which was very weird because my parents were never like that. If we didn't like something, they're like, oh, okay, you don't like it. But I was forced to try the cranberries for some reason.
And that you day. Refused.
No, I tried it and I immediately, so at the time we had carpet in our dining room area and the chairs that we were in that we had. And me being so young, I couldn't push the chair back myself when I was this young. And I took a bite of it, and I just remembered, like, I'm going to throw up. And my mom and dad just sat there, and were looking at me. I'm like, I had to slide under the chair, under the table, in order to get out to run to the garbage to spit it out.
We didn't throw up, though.
It was close.
Okay.
It was close.
That actually brings up a good side question, then. Are there any... And Corey, you probably don't qualify for this because you said your parents never made you stay at the table to eat something until it was gone, right? Other than the cranberry sauce.
Yeah, and
even then it was just try it.
Yeah, it wasn't like, yeah, you're not allowed to leave until you, it was
yeah.
just, yeah, here, try this. And I was not able to exit
the chair. Did you ever have anything that you couldn't leave the table until you finished? Orange. Squash. Orange squash, and then separately another time, egg salad sandwich.
Whoa.
I spent like 6 hours at the table. The entire Sunday afternoon gone because I wouldn't eat it. And they turned the lights off, told me don't get up. And I stayed there for 6 hours because I refused to eat it. And then they showed up for dinner. And I got nothing on my plate except that same fucking egg salad sandwich. Which I refused to eat, and then they sent me to bed.
Egg salad sandwich is good.
No, it's fucking disgusting.
No, it's
fucking really. Fucking disgusting.
How?
Fucking disgusting. It's egg salad.
Yeah.
No.
It's amazing.
No.
Oh, dude, I'll
agree to disagree.
Tear apart an egg salad sandwich any day.
All right, so we're going to start with Corey for this one, but we're going to eventually do everybody. Name three things that the person on your right is a fan of.
Men.
keep going.
Damn it. Just a lot of men.
men. Stop.
The DC Marvel Universe.
DC? What? I thought you knew me.
You're fans of it all. It's no, fine. Yeah. No,
big difference.
And
fan of Marvel, tolerate DC. Yeah,
exactly.
And vinyl.
Good going. High fidelity sound systems, Craig. Horror of any kind. I'll even say
don't the you printed call form, Katie that
of the of the printed form. And good scotch.
That's fair. That's fair.
That's how it's done. Yeah.
I'm gonna go documentaries, GoPro, and dips.
and dips?
And dip.
All right. Wow. I think he's got your number.
Say one out of three. I just watched the documentaries to give them to you guys.
He's like, if I'm gonna be miserable, you're all gonna be miserable.
Watching a documentary about vinyl while I have a chew in. Amazing. All right, Greg, are you left or right-handed?
Both at something. Like, I do several things left-handed, but I write right-handed.
Go ahead, Corey.
Everything right.
No, I assumed you had a comment on Greg's comment.
Oh, no, no, it's
no, you don't.
I already know he jacks out with both hands.
Thank you. All right, Greg,
he showed me.
So would you say you're?
I'm predominantly right.
Predominantly right-handed. Yep. So is there anything that you would do well with the other hand?
I do some things left-handed. Like I bowl left-handed.
You do? Okay.
Yeah. Throw horseshoes, but I do everything else pretty much right-handed.
Okay.
But there are a few things I do left-handed.
Oddly specific. Rather than going with cornhole. You went with horseshoes.
I like horseshoes more than I like cornhole.
Do you play horseshoes that often?
I play, well, I throw horseshoes left-handed. I throw a cornhole right-handed.
Huh. That is quite weird.
Did you learn something? This is what this is all about.
That is very weird.
Yeah.
All right, Corey, you right or left-handed?
I'm predominantly right-handed.
Okay. What do you do well with your left?
Well, the first thing I wouldn't say I do well, but I do it, or I've tried to do it.
No, that's not the question.
Shoot a basketball. I for some reason, do left-handed.
You mean like a layup?
No. When you position your hands on the ball, if you're right-handed, you use your left as support and the right to...
Right.
I go the opposite way. I use my right as support and left to shoot.
But when you shoot a layup, you go from the right?
What's a layup?
I don't think I've ever attempted a layup, Bob. There's a reason.
All right, we'll talk after the show.
5'9" white dude.
You can shoot a layup at 5'9".
They were made for people like me. I understand that, but
yeah,
layups suck. That's
all right.
Hockey, left-handed.
So that's significant. Okay,
I was pretty good at that.
All right. Yeah, that's a better answer than I shoot a basketball left-handed.
That's why I started with
never
it.
Never done a layup. I am right-handed. I don't think I do anything well with my left hand, unless you count like holding a fork and then put the knife in the right hand. I mean, there's nothing else that I can really. I could just lose this arm completely and I'd be fine, except for tying my shoes.
Let's give that a shot.
Be a challenge.
Yeah. We'll tie that behind your back one day.
Yeah.
See how well you do.
All right, we're doing on time.
142.
Oh my God. All right, Greg, what's one thing, good thing that you like? What this might be a little question. What's one good thing that you like that most people don't like?
Ooh, scotch.
Okay.
Because most people are whiskey or bourbon people or scotch.
I feel
scotch,
like most people don't understand scotch.
Yeah, like you're either one or the other. You either like scotch and don't like bourbon,
yeah,
or you like bourbon and you don't like scotch.
It's definitely an acquired taste.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, Corey.
After talking with you guys tonight, I'm gonna say documentaries.
You think most people don't like them?
No, I mean clearly most people.
What do you like that you think is good that most people don't?
Dollar shrimp from the dollar store.
Stay away from that stuff, man. It's not good.
That's a good answer. That is a good answer.
Anything off the roller grill from Speedway?
Oof. Oh my God!
Oh, damn.
The wasp dog.
they just start. So now that 7-Eleven's and Speedway, 7-Eleven's taking over Speedway.
Yeah,
all the 7-Eleven stuff is coming to Speedway, and the one by work started selling the maple sausage and egg taquitos.
That sounds so disgusting.
Oh my God, they're amazing.
If my stomach was full of food right now, I would throw up.
They're so good.
I would say vinyl, because most people don't understand why the fuck you'd bother.
I'd agree with that.
Yeah,
you have to be a purist to like vinyl.
I don't know.
There's a cult vinyl following behind.
I wouldn't call it a cult. That's pretty mainstream.
No, not compared to digital. Not compared to
because it's
compact
just
discs. No, almost. It's just, I think it just surpassed CD sales for the first time ever, sometime in the last year.
It's becoming more popular now. I would say like 5-10 years ago, 100%. It's becoming way more popular now with
people. But I think that people who know what it is, who are old enough to know what it is, or they're young enough to have looked it up and understand what it is, still don't go like, I don't think it'd be worth it.
I think most people, it's a trend now that are,
yeah,
that's moving to,
I like, think they see it as a trend. And
yeah.
Yeah. So
I don't know, man. I still think there's a way bigger following out there than
I mean, compared to past years, for sure. It keeps going up every year, but I just don't see. I mean, I should know. There's I post something every weekend on Instagram, and I get the same four likes from the same four dudes who also have vinyl, and there's it's the snake that eats its own tail. You know, there's no.
Well, that's because you have three friends on Instagram. So
yeah, well, I'm working on it. It's a work in progress. Do you have any friends taller than 6'4"? I think we can move past this. Beyonce or Rihanna?
Doing what to them?
Yeah, neither.
That's the only thing it says. You could read anything into that you want. Anything you want.
Rihanna's way hotter than Beyonce.
You don't even have to say it out loud.
Oh.
You could just say one or the other. And we will assume that it is the filthiest thing that you're thinking of.
But the only thing with Rihanna,
yeah,
she got that chest piece done, and
she also just had a baby, I thought.
Oh, I mean, that's fine. I'd still.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
For a couple million.
You like the young mothers?
Or old ones. Either way. No, she
Corey loves to tend to unwed mothers whenever possible.
So glad the wedding shower was today. Yeah.
She's not going to listen to this.
She has to some of them.
She's
going to be the one recently. That she listens to.
Yeah,
not recently.
I've gotten called out on a couple things in recent past. That
how recent?
3 episodes ago.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
What, was she bored? Why did she? What was she doing? Listen to this,
Bob. We produce a wonderful show that everyone should listen to.
Well, that's very kind of you.
So
it's the complimentary.
No, yeah. She wasn't bored. She was very busy, but knew she had to fit the Schnozcast into the schedule.
That would imply that every week she's got to fit it in.
Sometimes she gets a little backed up on the episodes, but.
Well, I never thought we'd be talking about Danielle being backed up on this show, but here we are.
But yeah, Rihanna's chest tattoo. Doesn't that?
I'm with you. Not a fan of chest tattoos.
Oh, it kills. Chest tattoos and thigh tattoos.
If someone's wearing a bathing suit and there's like a little tattoo peeking out of the room, like, nope,
moving on. Done.
Moving on.
Same thing with the thigh for me. The second you...
I don't know why I'm moving on like this, but...
Oh, that's clearly using your TV remote.
Yeah. Yeah. You're like, nope.
Moving on. Click.
Bob only gets Instagram on his TV. Yes.
If you haven't tried TV Instagram, you don't know what you're missing.
I can only imagine how frustrating that would be. High definition frustration.
Yeah.
Dark chocolate or milk chocolate? Oh, no, I never asked you Beyonce ever, or did
I
you
don't
say?
Care.
Don't care? All right, moving
neither
on.
Neither one.
Dark chocolate or milk chocolate?
I really do like me some dark chocolate.
Okay. We're talking candy now.
I know.
Okay. I'm with you on the
it's
dark
tough,
chocolate.
Though, man. I like both. Like I'm, if you put either one in front of me,
then you're just a guy faced with a lot of chocolate.
Yeah,
I'm with you on dark chocolate.
Can't stand dark chocolate.
Really? What is it about it that doesn't? Is like it? That, is it
the bitter
it tastes wrong?
The bitter kind of like you can definitely tell it's fake taste.
What do you mean? You can tell it's fake?
Like to me, that's what it tastes like. If
it tastes fake because of the bitterness.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I
get it.
Dark chocolate does not do it for me. So milk chocolate through and through.
Are you a Raisinets guy?
Oh yeah.
Have you tried dark chocolate Raisinets?
I refuse to. That's
you never tried them.
Not that I can think of, no.
All right. I may have to hook you up. Because that may change your mind.
Very unlikely.
Okay. Very. That was the that was the entry level drug to dark chocolate for me was dark chocolate Raisinets.
Yeah, no, because everyone in my family loves dark chocolate too. That's all the stuff they get is dark chocolate.
So you've single-handedly disappointed your entire family by...
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Not by just the dark chocolate. There's plenty, well, of, plenty of other
it's
things.
It's a slippery slope from there.
Yeah. But and especially my mom, too, because she's always had a candy dish on the kitchen counter for right. as long as I've lived. And every week, you know, gets replaced with this or that. And she'll always, every now and again, catch me off guard that I'd be like, oh, so, you know, whatever candy. And I'm like, oh, it's so good. I'm like, oh, it's dark chocolate. God damn it. And sure enough, I look at the wrappers. Oh, everything's dark chocolate. I'm like, yeah, that's can't do it.
Yeah. Greg, polka dots or stripes?
Vertical or horizontal stripes?
Whatever you
want. Who can say? Who can say, Greg?
Are you laying down or standing up?
Yeah. I'm going to go polka dots.
Interesting, Corey.
Stripes.
Stripes. Interesting, Greg.
Most of my golf shirts have stripes on them, but depending on which way the stripes are, they make you look really fatter than you already are. That's why I asked which way the stripes are. Polka dots don't do that.
All right. Fair enough. Last one. Do you like Disneyland? Are you a Disneyland fan?
Yeah.
Okay. Been there as a kid?
Yeah.
Plan on taking your kids there?
I mean, no, I would definitely like to.
Okay. Is that somewhere you would take Danielle, kids or no kids?
We've talked about it.
Okay. Is she a big Disneyland fan?
Oh, God. Her family is...
A lot of women are.
Which is really funny because I own stock in Disney.
Who doesn't?
I don't think anyone in her family does, but they absolutely...
Oh, do you lord it over them?
This conversation just made me realize that. So I think I'm going to have to start hanging that over their heads.
Okay.
But yeah, her brother lived in San Francisco? No, San Diego.
Yeah.
Which one's closer to...
Well,
I know...
The question is Disneyland. Disneyland's in California. Disney World's in Florida.
Right, right. But wherever he lived in California, they like him and his wife at the time...
Yeah.
Would go like 3 times a week.
What?
Yeah.
That is insane.
They had yearly passes they would get, and they would literally like they would treat it like how you and I would walk down to a local park and go hang out for a couple hours. That's how they would treat it.
So they had passes that literally allowed them to walk in and spend $0 and enjoy the park.
Yeah, I mean they spent a shit ton of money on the yearly pass, which I would debate
for the luxury of going there whenever they wanted.
Yeah, and at the rate they were going, like, yeah, I see where they were paying that amount for the pass. It weighs itself out.
Yeah, I guess.
Oh, dude,
that sounds insane to me.
No joke. I said it'd be like three times a week.
What's the park that's right?
Cedar Point?
No. Right there, right down the street.
Oh, Levagood. Holy shit, it's been so many years since I've been there.
You know the one I'm talking about.
I do, yeah.
If you told me you went to that park 3 times a week as a grown man, I'd be like, why?
For the kids.
Well, that's how Disney is these days.
Yeah, when you don't have kids, that answer gets you a criminal investigation. Mm-hmm. But so the same thing should hold true for Disney World. There's no reason why you should be going there 3 times a week. Unless even if you have kids, you are spoiling them to the point where they won't be able to talk to other kids.
They didn't have kids. It was just them going.
All right, I give up. Greg.
Never been. No desire to.
Disney World or Disney?
Neither one.
No Disney property. Never been? How does Katie feel about the Disney brand?
She loves Mickey. I don't know about the rest of the...
So you're going eventually.
Yeah, you're going to go eventually.
I don't know if she's ever been.
That means you're definitely fucking going. You're telling me you're with someone that you love dearly, who loves the fuck out of you. We've all seen the posts. it's one sappy poem after another. She loves you, and she's never been.
I don't know if she's been. I have to ask her.
Oh, I think one of us is going to ask her.
She'll listen.
If it's not you, it's going to be me or him.
I'll just wait because she'll listen to the show next week on Friday.
You guys are going to Disney after that.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, so.
I mean.
I can already tell you what her answer is going to be.
If there was a theme park that was centered around horror, and you were like, and she found out you'd never been there, don't you think she'd be like, you and I are fucking going?
We'd have a discussion about it. We'd we'd probably just go on a golf trip somewhere. Like, there's
no. This is a theme park based around horror films with the most amazing rides and experiences for true horror fans. And she found out that you'd never been, and she knew that you were a gigantic horror fan. You don't think she'd be like, babe, I think we need to schedule a trip. You think she'd be like, we should go golfing again?
Well, we would go out of town to golf. See, the problem is, you can't really go for like 3 days because of her work. She can't be closed for that long at a time.
I mean, at some point, she's got to be able to take a trip over 3 days long. I mean, at some point. So she can't ever take a trip.
We've taken, depending on like the way the holidays fall.
Yeah.
Possibly.
Okay.
Like Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
Would be the only.
But she'd have to close the store.
Yeah.
So it can be done.
Theoretically,
yeah. But I think if you could do it in 2 days, like a 2 day trip where you spend, let's say 2.5 days, you spend half a day traveling and then you spend like a day and a half at the park and then you go back the other half a day. I feel like she'd 100% take you to that.
Possibly.
Park. Yeah. That means, in my mind, that means you're fucking going to Disneyland at some point. You're fucking going. Because there's no way, if she loves Mickey and Minnie and all that shit, that she hasn't dreamed about going.
I'm pretty sure they've gone. I'd have to ask. I don't.
Yeah.
Don't recall.
Yeah,
I'll find out.
Yeah, give us some follow up. All right. All right. Let's wrap it up with a pick of the week. I think you've got a graphic for this, sir, but I do not have a. I do not have a sound for this. But pick of the week. So for this week, I probably should have done some work on this, but I think I'm going to go with one that I had banked, and that is, and I went there this week. Detroit Wing Company. I've not used them before. I checked. I thought that I'd had a pick from them in the past, but I have not. And there's a new one right in Allen Park on the hill at the bottom.
Oh, is there?
Yeah. So now I don't have to drive all the fucking way down to Taylor to get it.
Your favorite drive on
Telegraph? Which I would do like at least once every 2 weeks. I would go. Greek style, very well done wings.
I was gonna say you get the extra. You do the 14 minutes or whatever it is.
Yeah, cook that shit as long as you can, and fantastic.
You not know about this?
And in fact, when Todd comes in, when he came into town last, I've been trying to get him to go there because he's always a big B-Dubs fan, and they don't have B-Dubs on the West Coast. So every time he's always like, it'll be like 4:30 in the afternoon. Hey, what's going on? Oh, nothing, buddy. What are you doing? Just got into town. I'm going to be at B-Dubs in about 30 minutes. What are you doing? And I'm like, a little notice would have been great. Well, I'm going to be there from 5:30 to 7:30 if you're not busy. Love to see you.
Explains why he likes B-Dubs that much. I didn't know didn't have it out there.
Yeah, no. And he loved it when he was here.
Usually any time, Todd's in town, that's where I've always met them at. Todd will call Bob, and Bob will usually call me and be like, Todd's in town. If you want to, I'm like, B-Dubs.
Yep. But I was never a big wing guy, so when I would get wings out at B-Dubs, then I'm like, these are good, but they're not great. And then I can't remember if it was you.
Yeah, because Danielle and I went.
Yeah, turned me on to it, and I'm like, this is it. This is my place if I want wings.
So. Oh, dude, they're phenomenal. And you can get them. They'll cook them for like 12, 14, or 16 minutes. And, I've never had a crispier wing from anywhere.
Yeah, insanely crispy.
So, and they'll do like the all flats and all that, which I'm a huge all flat fan. So
definitely check it out. Corey.
My pick of the week is going to be my Nixon Regulus watch that I got several weeks back.
Yeah. Where'd you get that one?
Got it off Amazon, but I ditched my Apple Watch.
Is that a smartwatch?
This is not.
You went back to a regular watch.
Went back to the regular
watch. So tell me why, because I never bit, and you know me, I'm a technology guy. It seemed like it would be right up my laneway, but I never went with the Apple Watch. I just didn't see the, I I'm like, I always have my phone on me. I work from home, so I didn't see the need for it. It would be money spent just to have the latest, greatest thing.
Right. And it has.
You were a big Apple Watch guy.
Yeah. I mean, I still love it. There's still things that I definitely miss about it.
Yeah.
First and foremost, though, was the charging. To have to every day or every night, at some point have to take your watch off and charge it. I guess I just kind of got over that a little bit. I'm like, this is, we do the podcast and say, stay at Nick's. And the next day I'm like, shit, my watch,
is dead.
Yeah. And I mean, I could bring the charger with me to Nick's, but then it's like, I'm bringing the charger around everywhere. I'm like, that got really upsetting. The messaging aspect, no matter where I was at, I didn't have to take my phone out of my pocket. I could see my messages on my watch and respond to them, via voice, text, and all that. That was fantastic. I think that's probably the thing I really miss the most.
I guess I have to take my phone out of my pocket.
No, it really wasn't a hard transition. If anything, the hardest transition was going from having all my cards on my watch, mm-hmm. My debit cards. Excuse me, I got to sneeze.
Yep.
Yeah. I think we're good.
I will cut that out. I will cut that out.
I think that was probably the hardest thing to get used to was actually having grab my wallet again, grab my card.
Okay.
But I just wanted to disconnect from it for a while, if not forever. It got to the
You were too connected?
Because I'd feel my watch go off no matter what the notification might have been. A ring notification because the mailman was at the door and I was constantly doing this and always, oh, what's that? What's that? I'd get an email. Oh, what's that? And it finally hit me when I was the new position I took at work. I was training and mind you, it was nothing crazy. We were just sitting there and I was learning new shit that I had to do. But I caught myself three times while Shannon, the girl that was training me was talking. And I was like,
did you have a notification?
I had a notification. Yeah. I felt it go off, but they were BS notifications. It was nothing. But I'm like, oh my God. I'm like, I need to stop doing that.
You can
that.
Turn those off. The only notifications I get are text message, Snapchat, or Facebook message. That's it.
I know, but I'm like, I just want
to. Did she say something to you? Why do you keep looking
at her? No. No, okay. It was purely on me.
Okay.
I the third time I did, I'm like, what am I doing? I'm like, this is.
Yeah.
And it kind of smacked me in the face a little bit. I'm like, I you know what? Maybe as great as it is, because it is a great product. Mm-hmm. I'm like maybe I've just become too dependent on it, myself. And I'm like I want to step away from it for a while. So I purchased it. This is your bare bones minimalistic watch. The time, the date. Cool part, it does have a dual chronograph. Five alarms and ten countdown timers. One you can customize and the other are preset countdowns. So very, very straightforward, nothing fancy to it whatsoever.
Okay.
Haven't had to charge it.
And Nixon makes a good pro. I have a Nixon watch.
Nixon is very good. Yeah. And for the price range too, I think it was $159 on mm-hmm. Amazon.
Yeah.
And it's kind of G-Shock-esque, but they have their own little flavor that they put on their watches, and I've absolutely loved it. And I honestly don't think I'll be going back to my Apple Watch anytime soon.
There goes our sponsorship from Apple.
Son of a bitch, sorry.
Damn it, Corey.
I'll just keep wearing mine.
Greg, are you going to, is your pick your Apple Watch?
No.
Damn it. What's your pick?
So I'm going to go with the Berlinzo Premium Clear Ice Ball Maker.
Yes.
I brought some over here. Comes in a little plastic baggie that you can put your stuff in. So this one makes 4 ice balls at a time, and it's basically a cooler that you kind of fill with water. It's a little foam plasticky cooler. Fill with water, put the molds in, push it down slowly, make sure the water fills in. Put in the freezer, takes about 2 days, about 48 hours to freeze. Almost crystal clear. I think I took them out a little bit too early of the mold, but I mean, if you're in the into the whiskey or the scotch drinking. And,
yeah, so let's address this, Corey, as though we have a giant audience, most of whom are scotch drinkers or would love to learn more about scotch. So as a scotch drinker, what's the brand name of the maker again?
This one is Berlinzo.
Spell it.
B-E-R-L-I-N-Z-O.
Can they find it on Amazon?
Yep, it's on Amazon.
Okay.
Got it for my birthday last week.
And there is a science about having a glass of scotch with one giant ball of ice versus a lot of little ice cubes, right?
Yeah, it melts differently. I mean, I had that in here today, so it took 2.5 hours, and there's still some remnants at the bottom of this glass.
And so it's cooling the scotch without actually melting as much of the water.
Correct. The ice
into cube, the scotch as little ice cubes would do. Yep. Okay. I knew it was something like that, Corey.
Now, what are your thoughts on like the whiskey cubes or like the rock cubes?
So I do have some of those. I'm not I like the different flavors you get when water mixes in with a scotch. Okay. Like, 'cause it's some scotches can be night and day different from, oh, I have this scotch straight out of the bottle, or oh, I've let it sit there for, I've been sipping on it for 40 minutes and now the bottom tastes different than what I had earlier.
All right, fair enough. That makes sense.
For me, the whiskey cubes, they get warm too fast. This is my own.
They just haven't perfected that technology yet to.
Like, yes. I mean, you're pouring a warm liquid in it and it's not exactly ice. It's just a cube that you keep in your freezer.
Well, so far you're happy with the ice balls.
Ice balls. Yep. So far so good. I'm gonna get this perfected and have some nice clear balls here soon.
I was just telling Lori this morning. We literally were having this conversation about how, because she obviously has a 10-year-old son, and how 10-year-old boys will say nuts instead of balls way more than adults would, because nuts is just funnier.
I guess that's pretty true. I guess my go-to is always balls now.
Yeah. Balls, yeah.
Now it is, yeah.
Not nuts.
But part of that might be because...
I'm not 10.
We're maturing.
Because you're not 10. But in Planes and Trains, when John Candy looks over at Steve Martin, he's like, you play with your balls a lot. And he's like, I do not play with my balls a lot. And he puts like this extra... on it. There's like a few extra A's. And other than that, nuts is always funnier until you get to Steve Martin in Planes and Trains.
Fair enough.
Yeah. That's I'm claiming that to be truth for the week. So.
Well, nuts.
I'm nuts. Oh, nuts.
That's podcast of the week from Corey and Greg and Bob. Have a great week. We'll see you next weekend for episode 171.